Hey, what's up, guys? It's Renaldo here, and welcome to the Sunday Debate. It's the 24th of June, 2018. It's Sunday, and your weekend is officially over. Carte Blanche music played, and now you're stuck with myself and somebody called Jeremy Nell, also known as Jerm. Jerm, introduce yourself to the people.
Thanks for having me, Renaldo. Yeah, I'm Jerm. I am the 39th best cartoonist in the country. I've been trying very hard to go up the ranks, but I seem to hang around that number.
39th, that's quite a specific number. I'd like to know, who the other 38 above you are. But
well, I think there are only about 39 mainstream cartoonists in the country.
Well, that's quite shit that you put yourself last. But I suppose it's probably because you're hated by the fraternity, right?
I'm hated by everyone, yes.
That's actually a good thing to be, because I mean, you're hated equally all across the spectrum.
Yeah.
But anyway, so listen, there we go. So guys, thanks for tuning in. Be sure to hit the like button so that we can avoid the trolls in this discussion. Myself and Jeremy go back quite a while in the sense that I came across his cartoons, loved it, and he was aware of my YouTube channel because he also made very good YouTube videos about the News24 comment section back in the day. Unfortunately, News24 stopped that, so Jerm went out of business, so he had to fall back on his cartoons. I suppose that's accurate.
I would say so, yes.
Yeah.
Cartooning is such a stable career. You know, it's a good one to fall back onto.
No, exactly. And I mean, like you said, you're loved by everybody. So, yeah. All right. So we're going to discuss a couple of things. I think the most important thing that we can discuss, you and me specifically, because we fundamentally disagree on this topic, is free speech, what it means, and whether or not, you know, people should be imprisoned if they cross that line moving into hate speech. And that is even if you acknowledge that hate speech exists. So I think let's start with that topic. I'll give you the opportunity to start, and then I'll counter or I'll jump in, if I disagree.
Well, it depends on what you mean by free speech, first and foremost.
Okay.
I think a good place to start would be to separate private and public. So private free speech, I don't necessarily think is a right. In other words, you don't have a right to say what you like in my home, nor do you have a right to shout there's a bomb in the cinema when you're inside a cinema, because it goes against the natural order of things. So you will be removed from the cinema in such a circumstance. Or if you are in someone's home and you swear around the toddler, and the mother says, please don't swear, and you go, it's my right to speak how I want. No, you get shown the door and you leave. So in a private space, freedom of speech doesn't necessarily exist. But I think when we speak about freedom of speech, we mostly speak about it in a public sense, in the public space. And I think that's where it gets very, very interesting, because there are a lot of gray areas in terms of hate speech. I think logically, first and foremost, hate speech and free speech are not compatible as terms. You can't have free and then have restrictions, because then it's not free, because the definition of freedom means without restrictions. Okay, so a lot of people will say you can't say the K word because that violates freedom of speech. Well, no, you should be allowed to say that. I'm not saying you should, but you should be allowed to say it, because that falls into the definition of free speech. If you don't believe in free speech in its entirety, then say so and own it. Say I'm a fan of regulated speech or restricted speech. And then there's nothing I can say against that, because you then favor a speech that isn't free. Having said that, I don't necessarily favor free speech in its entirety either, because I don't necessarily think that singing songs to kill farmers at political rallies is a positive thing, because it motivates people in a very negative way. And I know that AfriForum won that case a few years ago. I think that might have been the right decision. I'm not entirely certain, though. I do admit I'm conflicted a little bit about such kind of speech. But for the most part, I think we should be able to say whatever we like, and the best way to respond is with free speech. Unless, of course, I'm going to be inciting violence immediately against you. That's not necessarily a good place to be, and we don't really want to encourage that kind of speech.
Yeah, look, I mean, it's sound reasoning. I do agree to an extent that, you know, freedom of speech is without limitations. But I do think that our Constitution makes provision for the limitations thereof by stating that, you know, this is what you're allowed to say. But as soon as your speech infringes on other people's rights, whether it be human dignity or whatever, then you are crossing the line. So it's pretty much like, we have the rules and regulations and the terms and conditions on the side that we should abide by. I think our constitution is one of the strongest in the world. No constitution is perfect, but I do think that ours is one of, considering where we came from in our history to where we are now, I do think that it has given people the right to express exactly how they feel. But I do think that there are certain things that are just completely off limits. And that, in my personal opinion, is things like the K word, and even in inciting violence. So I'm on both sides of the fence in the sense of whether it be to kill white people or whether it be to use a derogatory term that we know has caused so much harm, even though it can't cause direct, death or serious harm to a person. I do believe that psychologically it can affect that person.
Yeah, so, but it also might not. And that's the problem about having blanket rules. There are, for example, Trevor Noah did a show once where he told everybody to call each other that. Now, I'm not going to say the words because I know there are all kinds of problems, but he, in his show, told everybody to call each other that. And I thought that was quite clever. I'm not necessarily a fan of Trevor, but I really enjoyed what he was doing there, because what he was showing was that we either submit ourselves to the power of words or we don't give words power. If we have words, listen, if we mock words and we ridicule words and we make sure that they don't have any power over us, okay, they will never then have power. If we use them in excess, they become diluted, they lose their strength. Remember, we give words power. Words can't give themselves power, okay? There are people who get offended if you call them Dutchmen. And there are people who don't get offended when you call them Dutchmen. But now, do you create a law that favors those few who get offended?
Yeah, but that's the thing. You have to consider our history. You can't just consider... Look, I mean, for instance, not everybody is sound-minded in the sense of, or open-minded at least, to understand that words can't harm you. Considering the history that we come from and considering the environment of social media today, you know more than anybody, especially you being a cartoonist that's always on the fringe or always trying to push the boundaries, that it's a very difficult space to be in. And that is why people will abuse that privilege. I mean, if you say today that there are no consequences for what you might say, whether it is to insult somebody, based on the color of their skin, or whether it's to say I'm going to kill you because of your skin color, then I think you open the door for people to sort of be more who they are behind closed doors, but you're also opening up that possibility of people becoming more popular. For instance, let's use Julius Malema. I think that if Julius Malema didn't get as much pressure as what he's received from AfriForum and other civil rights organizations by the things that he said, he would have said it a lot more. And we all know how popular it is when he says that amongst your fringe left or fringe right, depending on where you see him on the spectrum. So I do think we need that check and balances in order to make sure that there are consequences for when you say something that is completely not acceptable.
Yes, I agree with you. But the checks and balances come from the market. It comes from the people themselves. You don't need to create a law, okay, for that check and that balance. If I say something stupid on Facebook, which I regularly do, people can respond. People can respond, and they do respond, and they will put me in my place. That's the check and the balance. The people are the best checks and balances. Because if let me give you another example. If somebody abuses a dog, all right, and you see that video clip on Facebook, people respond in a way that's appropriate. They go berserk. They create charities. They leave comments. They phone. The market deals with this stuff very, very efficiently, and it doesn't require state intervention. I'm not saying that people must go around insulting others. It's for the same reason I don't draw Muhammad, because it's an incredibly insulting a thing for me to do. Okay, I understand that I can draw Muhammad, all right, but I just choose not to, because for the most part it doesn't help my cause. It doesn't bring my message across any better. It just hurts people for the sake of hurting people. Okay, now I'm not going to go around insulting people and calling them the K word. But I can try and convince my friends and other people that I know not to be hurtful to others and not to insult. You don't run up to a granny sitting on a park bench, smack her, and then run away. Okay, that's very cowardly. So in the same way, you don't have to go and hurt people's feelings, but you don't need the state to regulate that and to make it a crime, because that doesn't actually fix anything. It just makes people into criminals. That's all it does. It doesn't change their mindset. What changes the mindset is persuasion.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I disagree a little bit with that, because here's an example, right? So I think the reason that it's important for us to have these checks and balances in the sense of our constitution in order for legal action to be taken is so that we don't have a situation in where people, you know, start spewing like hatred and racist things and build a momentum and then get enough people to sort of establish something that could possibly go into a civil war, as an example. I think the EFF is a perfect example of that. If we didn't have the freedom of speech with the limitation of the hate speech in South Africa and it being implemented by the government or the state rather, then I do think that we would have had a situation now where there would have been a lot more killings because of that.
Look, I don't know. That's a difficult one. What we do know, though, is that the most effective way to combat, let's say, hate speech, whatever that is determined to be, is with free speech. If you don't like somebody, you use your speech. That's what I do. I use my speech to ridicule. Now, if there was a law stopping me from ridiculing, let's say, Jacob Zuma, I wouldn't be able to draw Jacob Zuma and ridicule him, but I would still have those thoughts that I'd want to ridicule him. So it doesn't change me. It just stops me from presenting my speech. And what it might do is that it might take my speech into the shadows over WhatsApp and Facebook Messenger, and you start spreading it amongst groups where Jacob Zuma's allies who blocked you from ridiculing him can't see. And eventually they'll see, but by that stage, the Barbara Streisand effect has come into play in a big way. When you ban something, or when you prohibit something, you don't remove it. That's the reality. Do you think Penny Sparrow is suddenly no longer a racist after she was fined $150,000 or whatever it was? She woke up the next morning thinking, "Oh, you know what? I got fined all that money. Today I'm no longer a racist." No, I think she's probably more of a racist than ever before.
Yeah, look, I mean, I don't think that she's any less of a racist, but what I do think it has done, the same with Vicky Momberg, and I'll get to the double standard of the Vicky Momberg versus the black Vicky Momberg. I'm not sure if you know who that is, but what I think I can safely say that you would rather want racists out in the open so that we all know who the racists are.
Yes, that's exactly what I want. I want them out there so that I can see who they are, and then I can ridicule them.
Yeah, but then that's fine. The problem that I have with that, though, is that when you ridicule them, and as we've seen with social media and using Black Twitter as an example, when they are on social media and spewing the stuff that they're spewing, you start assuming that that's how the majority of people feel. When in actual fact, I think a statistic came out last week that there are 6 million South Africans on Twitter. So that already means that at most, there are 5.5 million black people that can be considered black Twitter. But not all of them might, agree with the notions of black Twitter. So my point that I'm trying to make is, so you assume that black Twitter represents majority of South Africa based on 5.5 million people saying, you know, anti-white this, and, you know, all the racist narrative. So what I would rather have is, I would rather have people being scared to say that type of stuff and rather living in the shadows, because in the shadows, they can't create something like a civil war. They can't create.
Oh, hang on. Stop right there. In the shadows, they can't create something. Well, let's just create a parallel for a second, if you will. Okay. Drugs are prohibited. So drugs exist in the shadows, and in those same shadows is where you find pimps and prostitutes and trafficking. And you don't know where they are. And when you do find out where they are, they're already dead people, and people have been sent across the border, and women who are being abused, because they've got nothing to protect them. Okay. That's what happens in the shadows. Now, in the same way, let's come back to free speech. If you push free speech, if you push words into the shadows, you're not removing them. You're simply shifting them from one space to another space. So it depends on what your goal is. If your goal is to take words away from the public space and put them into an area like in private homes, well, then that's fine. Okay, then have the legislation. But if your goal is to try and persuade and to change the mindsets of those people, legislation doesn't work. What works is what you and I are doing right now. It's chatting, it's debating, it's persuading, and it's also telling people to get a thick skin also, you know. Words can only hurt you as much as you allow them to.
Yeah, look, drugs is a bad example to use, because I believe that drugs should be legalized and taxed, and whatever somebody wants to put into their body, it's their decision to make. So for me, it would be like a double whammy to debate that, because I actually agree with you that that shouldn't be in the shadows. But comparing taking drugs and or prostitution, which strangely enough, I also believe should be legalized, because what a woman or a man decides to do with their own body is their own decision to make. Where I would disagree, though, is that you are trying to draw a parallel between drugs and using it and people insulting and infringing on other people's rights. The reason that I believe that it should stay in the shadows is so that it doesn't build a momentum in order to affect South Africa. Whereas, look, I mean, I understand the notion that drugs in the shadows is a bigger problem than if you had to legalize it. However, I do think that if you legalize people insulting other people based on their race and saying it's okay to say it, then we create the narrative, then by you saying it's okay to say that, it's actually okay, which it's not. So I think that, yeah, I understand. I mean, you and I can have a civil debate, yeah, without having to use any terms that is considered hate speech. And I'm talking into the current state of our constitution. If the government goes and adapts what is considered freedom of speech, then I will fight that along with you.
Yeah, but Renaldo, sorry. Words don't infringe on anybody's rights. Okay, let's just remember something. Words cannot infringe on anything. They're words. They're words. They are something that's abstract. They're nothing. It's just sounds that come out of your mouth. They don't.
Well, I get that. I mean, I feel the same about swear words. I think swear words has got no power. But the thing is, if you infringe on somebody's human dignity, for instance, like Vicky Momberg did, I do think that, you know, even though you're right that it can never hurt you physically, it can have a mental impact on you. And I'm not talking about your pansy social justice warriors. I'm talking about,
yeah, where do you draw the line, though? Where do you draw that line? Because who's the authority to create that line? If you're going to say it's the state, then we're going to go down the same road as we've seen throughout history, where democratic freedom of speech slowly gets eroded, and more words every single year get added to this list, until eventually that thermometer, that's gauging democracy, that free speech thermometer, starts getting colder and colder and or hotter and hotter, depending on which you want to take the mercury. If you look at the US, okay, there's a church in the United States called Westboro Baptist Church. They're often known as God Hates Fags, okay? And they've been around for many, many years, and they picket at funerals, and they're a vile group of people, but they're incredibly smart. They make something to the tune of 30 or 40 million US dollars per year from winning lawsuits on free speech. And as much as the judges who I've read, whose articles I've read, saying they hate making these rulings, they have to rule that the freedom of speech of those people within that church trumps the feelings of those other people around them who are suing them for infringing on their rights or on their dignity. Because at the end of the day, like I said in the beginning, hate speech and free speech are not compatible. And that's what the US Supreme Court, I believe, got right when they said, and I think it was in 2012, when they said that free speech and hate speech are not compatible. You cannot have both running at the same time. You either have one or the other, or you have free speech with regulations, but then it's no longer free speech. Then it's regulated speech. And for some bizarre reason, people don't want to own this concept. They want to have their cake and eat it. And that's, to me, very strange.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you're actually using an example that plays into my favor in the sense that the Westboro Baptist Church winning millions of dollars by something they're clearly doing wrong shows the problem. Do you think the Westboro Baptist Church would be as popular as what they are or were, at least? I'm not hearing a lot of them anymore. If their speech was considered hate speech and they were actually fined and or imprisoned for what they
did. I think you might hear more of them.
Yes,
because the internet has a wonderful way of circumventing countries' free speech laws.
Yeah. Look, I mean, I think that if we lived anywhere else in the world, more you know, westernized, I think first world, then I would agree with you that freedom of speech should trump everything. But I think considering the country's history and how close we actually were to a civil war, and how close, if you look at the EFF now and the narrative that's starting to come out, especially this anti-white narrative in South Africa, and that only white people can be racists and that blacks can't even be considered racist. I think that you're opening the door by saying, you know, it's all right to be racist. You have freedom of speech.
No, but hang on. What is the problem with being racist? Let's just create a hypothetical scenario, and I need to put a disclaimer here, okay? I'm not saying that I'm racist, underline bold, but let's just make a hypothetical conversation. You say to me, Jerm, you're a racist. And I go, okay, now what?
Well, I'm not sure what you mean, because I mean, if you're proven racist.
What I'm asking is, so what if people are racist? So what? This is weird narrative currently that's taken hold, like some sort of cult, right, in the minds of so many people, that being a racist is the worst possible manifestation of evil. It's just a thought process. It's what you think about people around you. I'm not saying it's good or I'm not saying it's good. Please hear me, all right? But what I'm saying is, so what? So what if somebody's a racist? So what?
No, look, I agree with you there. I mean, I think that I don't think the term is so loosely used lately. I mean, you are a racist according to some. I'm a racist according to some. Even people from the Renegade Report, like Roman, which I see as here, by the way, I mean, they considered right-wing and racist. And I know I'm not really worried if somebody is a racist. What I'm worried about is, considering our country's history and the fact that apartheid was established by people that were racist. So if you allow people with that mindset in order to gain enough control in order to do stuff, whether it be on the black side or whether it be on the white side, then you create that narrative that it is accepted to have that mentality. It's accepted to say that white people have less rights in this country than black people, or in the past that black people had less power than white people.
Yeah, and but then, that's what happens when the government creates legislation once again, and it goes back to the same thing. Government creating legislation for moral reasons, such as racism or words, never works out well in the end for anybody.
Well, I think our constitution has done well since 1996. When did our constitution come in? 96 or 7?
Our constitution hasn't done well.
I don't.
Our constitution is just a bunch of words on a piece of paper.
No, well, I mean, so is the Ten Commandments, and so is like the law.
It's the law
So,
that it's the law that matters, and the law
but the
is
law is
failing a
also
lot of
just
people. Well,
written on a
not the
piece of
law, but the
paper.
well, no, the enforcement of the law is failing a lot of people, a lot of South Africans.
Yeah,
And
well, look, the enforcement thereof. I mean, we can go for hours about the ANC government. By no means is our government competent of running anything more than a tuck shop, if even a tuck shop. The ANC was amazing. What do you call it? Overthrowing. I'm no, no. I forget what the term is. The ANC was a great revolutionary movement. The ANC is an absolutely terrible government. That is how I feel. So, what I wanted to say is, like, I understand that it's only words on a piece of paper, but I have a problem when people come and use this argument about hate speech, you know. So they say, well, you know, we can't lock people up for their words, but then what gives us the right to lock people up for their actions too, if you're going to come with a
because
philosophy?
actions can infringe on other people's privacy. It can infringe on their dignity. If I come up to you and I slap you to the face, I have physically infringed on your private space and your desire not to be harmed. Okay, I'm not going to come and slap you in your face because that would be a little bit too Capetonian. I would probably need to UNP. I need to be a bit more gangster.
At
But
least we have water,
yeah, I'll come and have a drink of water with you afterwards.
right? Awesome.
But a word, me saying a word to you, like everything that you and I are doing right now is words. We're not infringing on anybody's rights to anything. If people, and I see there are a few comments flying there, if people get offended by anything that we've said, that's their problem. Let me tell you something. Offense cannot be given. Offense can only be taken. I cannot give offense to you.
Yeah, well, I get what you're saying. I understand the concept of it, and I mean, I think it's a discussion that I think where I come in here, it's for me, it's because I know, and I do understand that you also know the history of this country. I just think that because of the history of our country, the Constitution came in the way that it came in order to prevent something similar from happening. And whereas you see it as it's okay to be out in the open and racist because then it's easier to spot you, I believe that it has the opposite effect. I believe that if you come out and you're an openly racist, it becomes as if it's accepted. And I do understand that you and I look at people like that and go, well, you know, these people are idiots for having this belief system. But there are many people out there in this country that look at individuals like that and they go, well, that's my hero. So I think that's why it's important to have the checks and balances from the Constitution, the freedom of speech versus the hate speech.
Yeah, but as we both know, the Constitution is open to interpretation, and that's where things start becoming very slippery.
Yeah, well, I agree with you there. I do agree. But I do think that the, you know, just for, I mean, how can I put it? I believe that the hate speech is quite clearly defined. It's when it infringes on somebody's human dignity. So, you know, if you use a slur like the K word in order to describe somebody, and I mean, that is, I know that Vicky Momberg wasn't sentenced because of racism. She was, you know, for crimen injuria or however the term is. But I do think that that, along with sending other people or sending a clear message out there, is the way to go, and for me at least, because then, you know, you get people that is going to say that type of stuff in the comfort of their own homes, which is fine because as long as it stays there and it doesn't create a narrative out in the public that it's okay to say stuff like that, then I'm fine with that. Just like I'm fine with you taking drugs at home and doing what you want, you know, to your own body.
Or drinking a scotch during a live video stream.
Or vaping. You know, so but yeah, okay. So I think that people in the comment section are very passionate about this. Some guy said that I should drink cement and harden the fuck up, which that's quite a unique comment. But I do think that, you know, I'm just looking at it from a holistic perspective because usually the same people that are the ones that say, you know, the Vicky Momberg shouldn't have gone to jail are the
She
same
shouldn't
people.
have though. She shouldn't
No,
have gone to jail,
well,
in
we
my
can
opinion.
discuss that. We can discuss that, but my point that I'm trying to make is that we have a lot of double standards coming from both sides. So there are people out here that say, you know, Vicky Momberg shouldn't have gone to jail. But then in the same breath, they say that Julius Malema shouldn't be able to say what he's saying and he should be in jail. So let's hear what you have to say about Vicky Momberg going to jail. What do you think would have been an adequate sentence, if any?
Well, it's look, she should never have gone to jail for insulting a police officer. Okay, what should have happened, I suppose, is that she was flying off the handle. Number one, right? And clearly being racist. Okay, sorry, excuse me. But again, like I said earlier, it doesn't matter if she was being racist. What mattered more is that she was flipping out. She was losing her cool. She just had a meltdown with that cop. Okay, that there would be where the issue is, where she need to be taken into, I don't know, custody until she's calmed down. But she didn't hurt the cop. She did nothing. She just said a whole bunch of words that the cop found horribly offensive. And I get that it's a very offensive word to a lot of people, but to other people it isn't. I've got a good buddy who's black. Am I allowed to say I've got that token black friend?
No, I wanted to say, no, you cannot say that you've got a black friend, because that's an excuse an apologist, a racist used.
But he believes that that if someone is racist towards him, the best response is just to simply move forward. Don't make a big deal about it. There's no reason to make a scene. You're not going to change their mindset. Just ignore them and cut them out of your life and carry on with people who add value to your life. Okay. Now, and I'm thinking about the Vicky story. The question is, why did she go to jail? Why? For words. What?
No, well, she went to jail for crimen injuria.
Yes, but for words. She shouted a bunch of expletives.
But yeah, okay, look, the thing is, like, as somebody with a psychology background, somebody that studied it, like, I firmly believe in mental health and how it affects you, you know, avoiding you from going into depression, panic attacks, all that type of stuff. Now, for a lot of people that, you know, have a thick skin, being called the K word or being called whatever doesn't impact you whatsoever. But then you get millions of people out there that their boss at work tells them, you know, that I'm disappointed in how you handled your job today, and they are close to depression. So, you know, I firmly believe that, you know, the aspect of words can have a deep impact on
well, listen
you.
To this. Yes, you might be right, okay? Words do impact people. But remember, those people who are impacted allow words to impact them, okay? Morgan Freeman a few years ago said, the most effective way to combat racism is simply not to talk about it. Okay, yeah. And to me, there's something very powerful in what he said. Today, there's this weird cult-like obsession with racism, with the things that people think and the things that people say. And somehow, this radical left mindset believes that outing people, getting them fired from jobs, sending them to jail is somehow a victory. Who's it a victory for? You're not changing those people. You're not making them non-racists. You're simply turning them into criminals. You're getting them unemployed. And what for? So that you can feel better and give yourself a pat on the back because you're so self-righteously virtuous. The mindset is very, very strange. And I'm talking about people like Eusebius, for example. Okay, whose end goal I wish I knew. I don't even think he knows, but
I think his end goal is to get as many Twitter subscribers or Twitter followers as possible. I think that's the extent to what it goes to. To be honest with you, sorry to interrupt you.
It's fine. But if my goal is to change your mindset about something, okay, then I want to have a chat with you about it and say, listen, Renaldo, I don't agree with your stance on rhino horn poaching. I mean, on rhino horn trade. Okay. Now, we can discuss it, and I can try my very best to persuade you to change the way you think. But that's using words. Then you might turn around and go, I'm very offended. You hurt me by what you said. Well, so what if you got hurt? Nothing happens when you get offended. You don't wake up the next day with cancer.
No, well, but you might end up with a form of depression, and you in a couple of months you might kill yourself.
But that's not because of me. That's because you've got issues with words.
Yeah, oh, well, okay, let's not get into the psychological aspect of what depression causes, because it's a chemical imbalance in the brain. It's like asking whether being gay is a choice or whether you're born with it. It's one of those arguments that I don't have time to get into. I see a bunch of people here say that I'm using my degrees as a way of trying to win an argument, which it's honestly not the case. But I think that it's fair to say that I might know a little bit more about psychology than Jeremy. And just like Jeremy knows a lot more about cartooning than when I do, like that's like me telling him how to draw a cartoon.
No, you're wrong. I know everything about everything. I'm a cartoonist, don't you know? We know everything about all topics.
Well, there we go. Exactly. So I don't have a point, but I hate the fact when people try and throw my expertise back at me, trying to make it seem like I'm trying to argue from a point of authority. Because, and I'm not doing that. I'm just saying that as somebody that has studied it for 8 years, I do know a little bit more than the average Joe on the street. But yeah, anyway, that was just to people in the comments. More specifically, Willem Petzer, which loves to be on this channel for some reason, if I can say that. Like, you know, he got a little bit of taste of liberalism and now he's back for more. Just can't get enough. Anyway, okay, so you look, I agree that I think Vicky's sentence was severe, considering, you know, if you, the whole aspect of it, what she said was wrong. I mean, she said it like 48, 49 times. However, I do think that if no action was taken, or if she didn't have to account for what she did, do you think that then that would have happened more often? I
Well,
think it would have happened more
action
often.
would have been taken regardless. The video ended up on the internet, and people would have ridiculed her left, right, and center. She would have been fined. I can't remember the details, but she certainly harassed that cop to some degree with all that shouting. If I were the cop, I would have just. Oh, you know what? I can't say that on a video stream because I will be called a sexist. But I certainly would have shut her up.
Yeah, all in all, you're believing in
But
equal
the
rights.
market, now what I'm saying to you is that the market, people, individuals are the most powerful when it comes to providing accountability. If a pub down the street opens and it says for Indians only, okay, the market will respond faster than the government will respond.
Yeah, I agree, but not everybody, you know, has that form of business or something in which they can find it. I mean, for instance, I understand that if she was self-employed, she would probably feel it to some extent. But then I can assure you that there will be a lot of people out there that would support her purely because of that. That what was that guy that refused to rent out to black people? He got a massive amount of support from like-minded or narrow-minded people. So yes, to an extent, you know, the market will decide. But then again, because of this country's unique history, you get people that would like to spite the other people by wanting to support that business. So yes, I agree, but I do think that it's important to have consequences to you know, actions like that. Specifically, if we allow people to go to jail for physically doing something, I think for causing like psychological impact, then I think also, you know, that needs to happen. So yeah.
You need to also define what your parameters are. What is it that you're wanting to achieve? Are you wanting to persuade people to no longer be racist, or are you wanting to criminalize them? Those are two separate questions.
No, I look, I'll be honest with you. I feel about the best way that I can explain it is by saying it is the same way that in which I support the death penalty. I support the death penalty in the sense of whether or not it actually causes less murders in the country. I just want justice to be served. So, you know, for me, it's not there to serve as a deterrent. For me, it's just there to actually enforce what's right and what is wrong. So to an extent, yes, I would like that racists not be as out and open in the public, you know, put it into the shadows. But
Hang on a second. Hang on a second. Are you suggesting that you believe the state is the best authority to determine, or the state's the best bastion of what is right and what is wrong.
Well, the courts aren't controlled by the state.
Okay, fair point. Yeah.
So irrespective of the government, I think that, look, that is another thing that, I mean, it's a fair thing that, I mean, because I've also been confused by, sometimes by that, but I think it's important that we acknowledge that our court system is still very independent as it stands right now. You just need to look at any decision made by the Constitutional Court. What is it, Judge Mohoeng, I believe. And to understand that, I think our court system is still very independent. So I wouldn't trust the state with anything, my tax money, even though I have to pay it. But I do think, in essence, that we need to have actions against people that infringe on other people's dignity. And
yeah,
I think,
this is where the stalemate is between you and me, is that I don't really believe that words are able to infringe on pretty much anything, because you can insult me all you want. My state of mind will determine how offended I get.
Okay, so let me give you an example. Somebody gives you a call tonight and they say, tomorrow at 11 o'clock, I'm going to come and kill you and your wife. I know exactly where you live, or not your wife.
But that's incitement to violence.
No. Okay, but it's still words. It is still words until action takes place.
Yes, but remember what I said earlier. I said that there are gray areas when it comes to freedom of speech. For example, singing Kill the Boer songs at political rallies, where you're kind of getting a collection of thousands of people into like a trance mindset. Okay, which is what AfriForum took legal and they won. And the other thing is incitement.
By the way,
hey,
they settled out of court.
And the incitement to violence.
Oh, chip, 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 chip. Anyway, sorry. Yeah.
And then the incitement to imminent violence is the other thing, because that is you telling somebody that you're going to harm them physically.
No, but okay, I hear you. But now you can't say that it's just words. And then on the other hand, you can say that, well, it's not just words when it's inciting violence. Because
I agree with you. I agree with you. But I did say earlier that there are one or two exceptions. And I did say that I am personally conflicted with certain words, such as incitement to violence and singing certain songs at political rallies. I tend to side more with AfriForum in that instance, because I don't think it's wise to get 10,000 people singing a song to go and kill people. Yeah. And whether or not it's metaphorical or not, I don't really care. It's a song that's talking about death and committing death and committing murder. Now, I just want to say something. You mentioned the courts are very independent. Just remember something, Renaldo. The courts are part of the state. They're an organ of the state. The Chief Justice, all right, is selected by the president.
No, yeah, well, yes, he is. But I mean, the Chief Justice is one of, I forget now, of how many that actually sit on the panel. It's to create as an independent, an independent panel as possible. So I understand that he's chosen by the president, but, he is one of many. Even though he is the Chief Justice, there are other justices that sit on there. On that panel that's selected.
Well, let me tell you something. Going back to Vicky Momberg, I do hope that her situation gets taken to the next level legally. I don't think that she should be sitting in jail, because that sets a very dangerous precedent for the future of free-thinking South Africans, because words then become criminal offences, and this is a place we don't want to be in.
Yeah, I can understand to it. Like I said, I think the sentence was a bit severe. I'll admit that. I'll be the first to admit that. And considering the double standards that we have in this country, which is something you and I will both agree on, it's unfortunate, because, for instance, we've got Vicky Momberg that did what she did. Then we had a black lady that did, in essence, exactly the same, but used white C words, or the white, or how do you say it? White and then the C word, to to, you know, lash out at white security officers, and nobody has even picked that up. I mean, I think the only news outlet that reported on that was News 24. And I believe
white cops, is that what you're saying?
I think you're being facetious, you know exactly what I mean. But white cops, well, yeah, okay, let me rather not say it. But I do think that, you know, the double standard is something unfortunate as well, because it's creating a situation where people are getting frustrated with justice. Or a lack of justice. But what people forget is that, you know, those individuals need to take that first step and then let the courts decide. But the majority of people don't understand that the courts don't go out and select cases. That it needs to be reported to them first. I don't know if you want to say anything on that.
No, not really.
Okay, I think wine is eating home, man.
No, I think we've gone around in circles here. Let's go on to the next topic.
Okay, that's fine. So the next topic, I want it to be your topic. So I want you to speak on cartoonists and what your opinion is on cartoon. I don't know what the term is, but the state of cartoonists in this country, if you will.
Excuse me. I've got a frog in my throat.
All right.
I think the state of South African cartooning is in a terrible place. I think that the majority of the mainstream cartoonists are very subpar. They are mediocre at best. Zapiro, for example, is the most well-known cartoonist. He's an incredibly good cartoonist. I don't agree with him on a lot of issues, but that doesn't take away the fact that he's an incredibly good cartoonist. I think that he's losing his way, though. I think maybe old age or something. No, I'm kidding. but I do think that he's losing his way a bit. And having said that, there's a bit of a context about why I think that the cartoonists by and large are subpar. And in no way am I saying that I'm a good cartoonist. I'm not trying to elevate myself. I don't necessarily think I'm a good cartoonist. I'm just very grateful that lots of people like my work and what I have to say. But there's a history here. So if we go back about 10 years or so, there was a group of cartoonists that got together. They called themselves Afro Cartoons, okay? And started by a guy, very, very good cartoonist, in my opinion, wanted to basically centralize all the cartoonists and get all the work into a central place, like an archive, okay, where everybody can go and see South Africa's best cartoonists in one place. Great idea, very novel. The problem, however, is that over the years, this group of cartoonists have become very mollycoddled and patted on the back to the point where the owner of Afro Cartoons, for example, is very intolerant. He's got a history of intolerance towards ideas that do not fit his worldview. If they do not fit his worldview, you're suddenly a racist or a sexist. I know this because he's verbally called me those things. and to such an extent now that the group is so mollycoddled and pampered, right, that they don't criticize one another, okay? They give each other gold stars for every cartoon they do. Now, if you're going to be a good cartoonist, and I really would love to be surrounded by great cartoonists, you've got to live up to that label of being the bastion of irreverence, of satire, of ridicule, okay? Have a thick skin. Say that you don't like the cartoon I did and tell me why. I will never get better if you keep telling me how brilliant I am the whole time and how amazing I am, because I'm not a 9-year-old. I don't need to be treated like a 9-year-old. And I think that is where South African cartoonists have unfortunately moved into. They've moved into this. They themselves use the term the safe space, and I say they because a lot of them are all in the same WhatsApp group, literally the same WhatsApp group of which I was part of, and then I was in a sense forced to remove myself. They wanted me out, so I left the group because they all found me too offensive. They found me too politically incorrect, And they all basically ganged up on me, calling me a racist and a sexist and all kinds of things. And yes, the clincher. The term racist was thrown around so many times that I, out of the goodness of my heart, asked, guys, please, can you define what you mean by racist? I would love to know, because I understand the dictionary definition, but these days people make their own definitions.
Yeah.
The moment I asked that question, the owner of the group of Afri Cartoons told them that it's a trap. They mustn't answer the questions from Jerm. Okay. And not a single mainstream cartoonist answered the question of what it means to be a racist. Not one.
The thing that I see is, and it's concerning, is the fact that cartoonists are known to either be completely loved or completely hated at the same time, by which either side, you know, you are portraying in that cartoon. And it's also a cartoonist's job to ask the difficult questions, in my opinion. From the cartoons that I've seen you've drawn, Zapiro and many others, Wiggles here in Nelson Mandela Bay, it's something that you almost want to, you want to be criticized, because that is the point. It's to get people talking. And it's quite concerning that if you say that people are questioning, you know, what you are doing based on that fact, and just loosely using that label. It's concerning for cartoonism in South Africa, I won't lie.
Sorry, I need to just give me a second.
That's fine. Get it all out. Get the bullshit out of your system.
I genuinely believe that. Yes, I sound like that American that model. Remember that something about Iraq and the Iraq, and remember that.
Oh yes, the one that spoke about.
I genuinely believe that something about South Africa's needing maps or something. I forget her name now.
Oh yeah. Is because I remember that.
No, what I was saying is, I genuinely believe that most cartoonists want to be good. They want to push the envelope, but they have a fear of losing their job. All right, so they play safe. That's the first thing. The second thing is, they don't want to be ostracized by their colleagues. All right, I know all about that. I've been fired plenty of times. I've been ostracized left, right, and center. I know what it's like to be labeled absolutely everything you can imagine. And this is just from cartoonists, the guys who are supposedly bastions of irreverence, which is fine. I don't mind all that, because it says more about them than it says about me. Mm. I like to battle ideas, okay? And I can do that in my work, and I can do that now, like with you, right? But the problem is that cartoonists in South Africa don't want to, by and large. They're too scared. I don't know what it is. They're afraid. They don't want to step out of line with one another. They don't want to be judged by one another. And I've been in panel debates with cartoonists many times over the years, just last year, in fact, where I was told that we were going to do a debate about free speech, okay? We didn't end up debating free speech at all. You and I have spoken more about free speech than I think I've spoken with any cartoonist about free speech, all right? Mm-hmm. The debate was mostly about Zapiro and how great his cartoons are and him being sued by the president. The same discussion every single time. And it's got nothing to do with free speech. It's got to do with him. And I kept on trying to bring the debate back to free speech, and no one wanted to discuss it because nobody actually knows what it means. And they don't want to debate the concept. They don't want to battle the idea.
But do you think that is because, how can I put it? I believe that everybody is affected by having to pay a mortgage at the end of the day. And what I mean by that is in order to put bread on the table. So, you know, a lot of cartoonists would like to claim, you know, being not affected by the outlet that they're hired by, and that they've got a lot of, what do you call it, freedom of wanting to draw. I mean, but you've been a victim of that too, where you've lost jobs because you according to the outlet, felt like it didn't speak to the readership. So how much do you think it affects, especially the cartoonists of this day and age? Maybe because print media is a dying form. And I'm not saying that you guys solely live on print media, but I do think that, you know, the cartoonist circle is getting smaller and smaller in South Africa because of the medium, in essence, dying. How do you feel about that?
Well, I saw the signs years ago. In about 2012 already, I started migrating from print to digital. My work now is almost entirely online based. And I've managed to build my career around being online based. And in fact, I love it. I do print media, and I'm still hovering around print media, but I love the internet space. It's got massive reach. It's just a great space to be. I don't have to worry about physical printing limitations. But I've decided to try and make a career from using the online space. A lot of cartoonists don't. They just rely on maybe a single newspaper and two magazines or something. And then when they fold, then they're stuck.
Yeah, I think that is why it speaks to them being more conservative. I think that'll be, I'm not sure if it's an accurate term to use, but I've noted that your cartoons are a lot more liberal, strangely enough, even if it's at the detriment of liberals. I know that Zapiro, a lot of people say that Zapiro has lost his edge. I believe that Zapiro relied too much on Zuma for material for so many years that is why he's lost his touch. And his claim to fame has gone from being somebody that, you know, drew the actual state of South Africa to actually drawing the true state of Jacob Zuma, which, you know, was great at the time, but now it's the only thing he's known for, when his body of work is so much greater than just Jacob Zuma.
Well, exactly. But, you know, all cartoonists have got their thing, and that's his thing, and that's great. You know, I've always said he's one of the best cartoonists in South African history, but there are many other great cartoonists. They just are very underground. Nobody knows who they are. And the ones in the mainstream, in my opinion, are very subpar, because they are not actually pushing any kind of boundaries. They're just reacting to a story, and they're making a very bland comment because it's the safe way to do it. And I get that, because when you're tight on cash, that's what you do. But let me tell you something. One of the biggest challenges that I had was when I worked for the Guptas between 2010 and 2012. I worked for the New Age, and let me tell you something about being restricted.
I actually, it only clicked now that you actually worked for the Gouws.
Yes.
It's actually quite crazy.
It was one of the greatest experiences I've ever had. I would never buy the newspaper, and I hope that nobody else buys the newspaper. And I know that nobody buys it, because it gets handed out for free. But I had an amazing experience because of the tight parameters that I was given to work within. It forced me to become extremely creative without compromising my backbone ever. And when I was fired, I was proud, because I knew that I'd never bent over the wrong way for those guys.
Yeah, and I mean, now you've vindicated, eh? Well, at least to some extent.
Yeah.
Listen, I wanted to ask, what has been your most controversial cartoon in your opinion?
I don't know.
What have you, if you don't know a single one, what do you think is the narrative that's being created at this moment in time about your cartoons?
I'm being painted as a right wing. In fact, I've often been touted lately as South Africa's most right wing cartoonist, and Virashni Pillay, from former Huffington Post editor, called me alt-right. And I don't know what that means, but I quite like the term. It sounds much better than right wing.
Yeah. Well, with all due respect, her like criticizing anybody shouldn't like have any people go to or have sleepless nights. I mean, the Huffington Post, enough said. Same with the Daily Vox. I mean, the Daily Koch, more like it, eh?
So I don't consider myself left wing or right wing. I don't really care too much about political ideologies. I used to, but I've grown up now. I see myself more as a person, an individual who bases his work on a set of personal values and principles. Okay, and it might appear that a number of those values and principles are what maybe right wing traditionally or traditionally white right-wing people might hold dear to themselves. For example, I might dislike unions and the effect that unions have on a country, and particularly the protection, the state protection that unions get. You might say that's a right-wing position for me to have. Okay, fair enough. But I believe that rhino horn trade should be legal. Now, that's probably, I don't know, I'm imagining that's a left-wing perspective. I also think that prostitution should be legal. I also think that drugs should be legal. And I also think that all kinds of marriage should be legal. Now, that's, and the church and the state should be separated. Now, that's, I'm guessing, quite liberal / left-wing, which is why I don't buy into this whole left-right politics nonsense. I'm an individual, and I look at the world in a certain way, and my own values, my own principles determine how I respond to that.
I think that's a good way of putting it, because I'm like you, I'm also very like hateful of the isms, because I don't think that everybody is one specific thing at any point in time. I would think that a cartoonist specifically would be more in the center on specific topics, or at least at its core being a centrist, leaning maybe towards the left or right on specific topics. I do think, though, that, you know, the whole being forced into what you need to be, or being labeled an alt-right, or being labeled, you know, whatever. I mean, I've been labeled everything from everybody as well, depending on what side they stand on. You know, I've got people that label me a social justice warrior, even though I hate social justice warriors. I've been labeled extreme right-wing, even though I really, really dislike extreme rights as well. So, I mean, it's one of those tricky situations where you just... It's rather, you'd rather just not care what people label you as.
Sorry, yeah, I just saw a comment now there. There's a comment there by a guy called Dono, and he says, "Damn, I thought I was SA's most right-wing cartoonist." I know exactly who Dono is, and I think he is probably South Africa's most right-wing cartoonist.
How dare you say that, Jerm? You exactly now just like the other people that put labels on you. But yeah, let's actually move into that part of the discussion, though, because I do think that the one thing that I've noticed with regards to your cartoons as of late, it's got a tendency to call out the hypocrisy of from my experience, at least, from Black Twitter, or the outrage from racism towards the one side. So I think it was one cartoon that where somebody was sitting under a tree, and then it said, "Look at Zululand, and how perfect they are at preserving their own culture." And then on the other side, it's got exactly the same image, but showing Urania, and it's got people that pointed out and said racist. So I'm not sure, like, I know who you are. So I know that you are not saying, you know, that this is the case. But let me rephrase it. I think that you are drawing cartoons based on the hypocrisy of people rather than your belief system of what you are. So whatever you might be, a liberal, a centrist, or whatever. I'm not sure how close to the truth I am.
I think you are getting quite close. The great thing about political satire is that I've drawn somewhere between 6,000 and 7,000 cartoons. So I can probably say I'm experienced.
And well, let me put pressure on you now. You've said now that you've drawn that many cartoons. I've been begging you since 2014 to draw one damn cartoon about me to use as my picture on YouTube.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Left, right, and center. Guys in the comment section, I've got him exactly where I want him. Put pressure on him to draw a damn cartoon of me so that I can use it as my profile picture on YouTube, please.
Yeah, you know what the problem with that is? Is that drawing cartoons of people means that you'll probably never be friends with them again, because you don't bring out their good traits, you bring out their bad traits.
Please bring out my worst traits. I honestly just want, I am a fan. I'll be honest. I love your cartoons. I think that you are arguably one of the best in South Africa. Even though, like, we're having this debate, you know, and we disagree on stuff, I would honestly like it. So the whole reason I actually have you here is just for that specific point.
All right.
So now we both know where we stand.
I will do something for you, Renaldo. Going back to
We'll
your
see. We'll
question,
see. Yeah, sorry.
about the cartoon I did about Zululand and Aranya. Firstly, I think Aranya is a great concept. Okay, I know that Aranya gets a lot of stick in the media, and I don't really care too much about what the media says. I think the idea of self-determination is a good one. I strongly support it, and I see nothing wrong with freedom of association in that sense. I see lots of problems with people harming others, but I don't see people harming one another in Zululand or, let's say, in Oranje. Okay, so that aside, I think that it's very, very important that we allow people to associate freely, even if we don't like it. We can try and persuade them not to, but I don't really care for Oranje in terms of its geographical location. I have no intention of ever living there, but I certainly have no problem with their existence. Other people who have a problem with Orania's existence have nothing better to do, because if they're living in Joburg or in Cape Town, why do they care about what's happening in Orania? There's no crime there, just about. No one's being harmed. It's its own weird little like redneck part of the country, and that's fine. Let them have it. It's okay. It's great. There's
I
nothing
think,
wrong with it. It's
let me jump
part
in
of
there.
freedom of association.
Yeah, but okay, it's self-determination. And I think this is a thing that we said we're going to discuss. The problem I have with that is if a black individual goes to Rania and he associates himself as an Afrikaner, he won't be allowed to stay there.
Neither will I.
That, no, oh, yeah, I get that. I get that. But the thing is, it's forcing people based on a specific race to live in a specific area, which you're not forced to stay there, but you're not, if you really associate with Afrikaners and the plight of Afrikaners, but you are black, then you are not allowed to stay there. And I think that is a problem. I think if they said if anybody that would like to live here, but live according to the Afrikaner principles, which is something that you can control, versus something that you can't control, which is your skin color, then I think it's absolutely idiotic that you would want to even live there, firstly, and secondly, have a place like that where you do something like that. And that's
But
something
I
I
don't,
can't agree with.
sure, maybe, but I still don't see the problem. So what? Then don't go there.
No, I get that.
I don't, there are many places I have no desire to go to in the country, and I have no issue with their existence. I live in Cape Town, and I'm quite happy to live in Cape Town, and there are probably more racists in Cape Town per capita than there are in Oranje, because in Oranje, they're living their own life, trying to develop a town, and they have a lot more worries on their hands than what we do here. The only worries we have really is water, okay, and traffic.
That's quite crazy. I honestly don't have a problem with self-determination on principle. The issue that I have is why it's necessary in the first place. I think that if you want to associate and be narrow-minded and only associate with your kind, whether it be Afrikaners, whether it be English-speaking people only, or whether it be black people, I think that deserves to some extent a point of criticism, because you at least from my point of view, is you're trying to like not experience or grow as a human being, because you just want to be associated with what you know. And I don't
Yes,
know,
that's
it's
fine. I agree with you, but at the same time, not everybody thinks like you, and this is what makes planet Earth a beautiful place. We are 7 billion individuals, right? All with different worldviews, and you can't force people to live together who don't want to live together. As stupid as you might think they are, you can't force them. You can force them, but all you're going to do is create conflict. So let them go and stay in some crappy part of the country that's dry and nobody wants to go to, and leave them.
like I said, I don't have a problem with it. I don't have a problem with the concept, but I do think if you're going to create a criteria that is based on something that people can't control, then that is a dangerous precedent, because
Well, you know what?
then.
You and I need to debate again, because I'm going to Aranya quite soon to see it for myself.
I've got no doubt that it's probably a very well looked after and well functioning area. I've got no doubt that it is. in my personal opinion, it's just a place that I wouldn't want to be, because, you know, I enjoy multiculturalism. I enjoy the experience of something that isn't in my comfort zone, you know? So I don't have any doubt that it's probably not well run or well maintained, and that crime is low there. I just think that for me, at least, it's a problem when you just want to associate with people of your kind.
That's and I get that. And I know that lots of people think that, and I know that that's a very popular mindset, but let me add to it. Zulu culture has a very proud history, and I have no issue whatsoever with pods of Zulus living around the country, trying to maintain their heritage, their history, their culture. Nothing wrong with that. And if they don't want me to live there, I'm okay with that. I'm very much okay with what Indians, let's say they want to have their own little area where they want to associate amongst fellow Indians, okay? Of which I believe there are, I think, maybe 2 million or 1 million, or 1 million, I don't know what the number is in the country, but a substantial amount. I have no issue with that. As long as they're not harming anybody. If they're harming someone, that becomes a different topic of discussion. But I'm interested in people harming one another. And if they're not harming me, I don't care.
Yeah. Yeah. Like I said, on principle, I might have some issues, but I don't really have an issue with it. It's like one of those, if people want to do it, then let them go and do it. I mean, it doesn't impact me directly. So
of course, and pretty much the same. For example, if you want to be gay, come to Cape Town.
Hey, the pink dollar, eh? Although, I don't know, like Cape Town, what is your feeling? Let me go a little bit off script here. Like, there's a lot of tension currently in Cape Town. I know that you've got the Gatful Coloureds, or whatever they call them.
Gatful Cape Townian.
Gatful Cape Townian. So how is that whole thing? What is your opinion of the atmosphere in Cape Town currently, considering, Patricia de Lille and the whole matter that's going on there?
I don't know too much about Gatful Cape Townian. I think they are quite funny, and I recommend people follow them on Facebook. They are hilarious and incredibly entertaining, and I do think they're very passionate about what it is they're fighting for. And I certainly follow them, and I find them very entertaining. In fact, I've chatted to one of the guys. The sentiment in Cape Town, I think, is probably by and large the same as it's always been. But I have seen in the last couple of years what seems to be an increase in a desire to separate the Cape from the rest of the country. There definitely is an increase in interest in this particular idea. I don't oppose it at all. I once again, because I support the idea of self-determination, I have no issue with the Western Cape becoming an independent republic. But it's probably not likely to happen, but I certainly have seen what appears to be an increase in interest in this particular idea.
But I mean, I think that is where the United States got it right to an extent, where every state is far more independent than what the provinces are. I do think, I mean, and I'm going now on to the point of you know, the provinces' independence versus the national government. And I'm not sure. I don't think that seceding would really help anybody in the long run, because what is the point? Because you are still allowed to move freely across the country.
Now I'll tell you what the point is. It's very simple. The more centralized a large population is, the more conflict arises. Because the Western Cape, for example, has a vastly different set of cultural traditions than, say, what KZN does. And yet, for weird reasons, they have the same laws. Now, in the United States, you have federal laws where one state differs from another state. And that's because of very different population groups. It makes perfect sense to me that KZN would have different laws to the Western Cape.
Yeah, I think it's like comparing to like the New York State compared to now obviously I'll forget it, Texas. what is Texas? Texas is a state, yeah. So it's comparing those two to one another. And I think it's similar to might compare that, the Western Cape to KwaZulu-Natal in that type of aspect. So it's actually quite an interesting discussion to have whether, something like that would actually work. I don't think it'll ever happen in South Africa, but I do think that maybe if we had something like that from the start, then there would be a lot more unity in this country because, if you felt like the Western Cape represents your principles more, then you can move there. And even though
Yes.
you can now, but I mean, the provinces be more, how can I put it? The provinces could be more proud of whoever they wanted to represent,
Yes, and just keep in mind that it wasn't that long ago Namibia was part of South Africa. So
Yeah,
the
that's also
Western
true.
Cape seceding can happen. It just needs enough support. And like I said, it can happen. In our lifetime, it's not likely, but I have seen what appears to be an increased amount of interest in it.
Yeah, that's also true. I have to ask you though, which political party, I'm not sure, you don't have to answer it, but which political party do you align with most? And if you would like to say who you vote for, or you can keep it secret if you want.
I'm not going to say who I vote for, but I will say that I do not support the ANC, I do not support the EFF, and I do not support the DA. And I know that you're quite friendly with the DA, and I have no issues with that whatsoever because I'm not weird like that. But there are a lot of policies that the DA support that I simply cannot support. I don't like the idea of data being a human right. I think that's absurd. I don't like Musi Maimane playing the race card as what he's been doing. I think that he is a terrible leader, and I think that the DA is slowly becoming too much like the ANC in the sense that they're becoming more and more populist. However, I am open to debate about that because political parties are all about winning support and changing and evolving. But as I said, I do not support those three main parties. The other parties at all, it comes more down to what I feel like closer to the time.
Yeah, I hear you, and that's actually a point that Adams made last week, is in that he said that he will decide who to vote for close like a week before the elections, which is honestly something that I don't have a problem with because I do believe that the parties need to step up their game and show what they intend to do for the voters. I think that's important. Full disclosure, I do work for the DA, but I don't want to answer on their behalf for obvious reasons because I'm not the spokesperson for the party. So yeah, I'd rather stay clear of your the claims that you've made,
Let me
for
also
obvious
just
reasons.
say though, let me just say that I'm talking about the party or the parties as a whole. I have
Yeah,
no
for sure,
issues
for
with
sure.
certain individuals. I think, for example, Helen Zille is great. I think she's been given a hell of a bad run in the media. I think the internal politics of the DA are starting to show with regards to her. And there are other people within the DA that I have no issues with. But as a whole, I have lots of issues with party politicking at the moment. And for me, I will happily vote DA if they bring themselves, in my view, back to a space of integrity and winning me over in terms of what it is they are about. Because I can't tell you what the DA represents anymore. All I can tell you is that to me, the DA is the same as the ANC, just with different colors. And the one thing I do support the DA on is their opposition to land expropriation. Let me also say something very important. Being heavily critical like this of the parties, I think, is a good thing because it's the way to hold them accountable. Remember, people often say that satire is very negative, and it is to a large degree. But keep in mind also that it's holding people to account. You ridicule for the sake of excellence. You want them to be better. You don't you mock mediocrity. You don't ridicule excellence. You don't make fun of people who are doing a great job. You make fun of people who are doing a terrible job, and you want them to do better. The truth of the matter is, I really wanted Zuma to succeed and to do well. I didn't want him to fail because if Zuma failed, which he really did, we all start failing and the economy tanks. What would have been amazing is if the economy flew and everybody started getting jobs everywhere and prosperity was booming. You wouldn't have seen the EFF because there wouldn't have been a need.
I'll wholeheartedly agree with you on that point, even though I am involved in, you know, obviously the Democratic Alliance. I do believe that everybody should hold their party accountable. And, you know, criticism is something that this is my opinion on it. The reason the ANC has gone so far backwards is because they just, every election cycle, got the votes and they weren't held accountable as much as what the opposition parties are being held accountable. And I think that there is a different standard for the opposition parties in this country versus the ANC. The people that want to vote for the opposition want to make sure that the party that they vote for is better than the party that's currently in government. So I agree with you there. And I do think that, you know, criticizing the DA, criticizing the EFF is the right way to go about it, because that it makes the voter more aware. The problem that we have, however, in this country is that the ANC has relied on their rural support for so long, because the rural area is where most of the people aren't aware of the failures of the government and aren't aware of the, you know, what's going on in the pulse of South Africa, because it doesn't impact them. They don't need to really care about that. I don't know if you want to say something on that.
Yeah, you know, yes. But remember, I base a lot of my decisions on my personal values and my personal principles. And I can't bring myself to supporting a party that supports something I fundamentally disagree with.
Is there a party that you wholeheartedly agree with 100% on everything?
No, there isn't. But I cannot vote for a party, for example, that wholeheartedly supports affirmative action, because in my view, affirmative action is completely racist. I understand why it exists. I know it's a noble cause. I know it's about leveling the playing fields, because that's the term we often hear. But the fact of the matter is that it prioritizes a person's skin color over their skill. That is the definition of racism, politically speaking. Okay, when you put somebody into a position on a sports field or into a job, first because of their skin color and second because of their skill, then you're unfortunately going down the road of racism, and that's discrimination based on skin color, and it's not something I can support. I believe in skill first, even if it means an all-white rugby team, and even if it means an all-black soccer team. I'm okay with that as long as the best players are selected. And if you don't get selected, it's because you're not good enough. I understand that there is a context. I understand that there's a history. But it's not the coach's fault, for example, if he is not given the best players. That must come from school-level rugby, school-level soccer, school-level cricket, and then into the clubs. By the time it reaches the Springboks, there should be no problem whatsoever with the skills of the players. And the same should apply in jobs. When you get to that high position in the company, it must be the best person for the job, because at the end of the day, your role is to make a profit, is to turn over the most amount of money for the company and to employ more and more people. That's it.
Yeah, look, on sport, I wholeheartedly agree with you. I think that it is not something, if you want the quality of sport to go down, is then to give people positions in the sport team that honestly is not the best in their position in South Africa. And that you've seen that to an extent with the Springboks over the last couple of years. No comment on that. But what I want to say, though, is you see that. In sport, you physically see that. When it comes to affirmative action, and look, I'll be honest, and I have been honest on this. I am torn about it, because is it racist? It's up for debate based on the history of this country. You know, what better policy is in place currently to uplift people that were oppressed for 45 years and even longer before that through colonialism, right? That is a question that you need to ask. What is the best way of implementing a system that helps people and give them an equal footing?
Yeah, but why must you and I who've done nothing wrong in that sense suffer? This is a very loaded question, I understand, but it's also not fair to make people who've done nothing wrong suffer because of something that happened a long time ago.
The way that I see it, the way that I would answer it is in exactly the same way as in history. History is not fair. There are people, like, history wasn't fair to 6 million Jewish people that died at the hands of Hitler. It wasn't fair. It wasn't fair that generations of families were wiped out and the Jewish people had to move all across the world, and in order to live their life. In the same way that the Boers, after the English put them in concentration camps or their women and children in concentration camps and had to rebuild, wasn't fair. But something needed to be done in order to sort of uplift the people after the incidents that took place. And that is exactly, it might not be fair to the generation after, but it's something that needs to happen for the betterment of the country.
Okay, shall we put 6 million Germans into concentration camps just to level the playing field?
It's not the same though. It's not. You're being facetious now. What I'm saying is that the policy is might not be ideal. Look, I don't agree with the way that affirmative action and black economic empowerment is working in this country currently. It's creating a few billionaires instead of many people that could be placed into the middle class category that can, in essence, assist the country. So long term, it is for the embetterment of South Africa and the improvement of the country as a whole by leveling the playing fields and creating more taxpayers, because that's the end goal for the government. The government only cares about getting more revenue in order to provide services. So it might not be fair to especially the youth in today's world. I mean, it wasn't fair for me personally, but, it's something that I was like, I can accept, having to be the punching bag, my generation at least, in order to assist people that were oppressed for 45 years.
Well, I've got a great solution.
Okay.
Instead of implementing legislation that penalizes innocent people for the wrongs that descendants did, simply make all people equally free. Give all people equal opportunity, not equal outcomes, because that creates a disaster. We saw that in Soviet Russia, okay, where you're trying to get everybody equal. And by the way, this term equality is a term that I hate because I don't know what it means and nobody can explain it to me, but we'll come back to that if you want. Equal opportunity is the most important thing in life. You and I must have the same opportunity to become a pilot as people in the townships and as women. I say women because apparently there's this whole big gender thing. So women and men must have the same opportunities to apply for whatever jobs they want. And all people of all ethnicities must have the same opportunities to apply. Now, the problem is that you have poor people growing up in townships and wealthy people growing up in very rich areas. So it goes without saying that to some degree, and to maybe to even a large degree, the people in the wealthy areas will have a much easier chance at getting those opportunities, right? Yes, okay, fine. That's the way the cookie crumbles. We can't all grow up in wealthy areas. We can't all grow up in poor areas. There's no possible way that you can make all people start out life with the same situations around them. The best that we can do is to try and create a society where prosperity is the first and foremost a drive, motivation, okay? You don't want to have an economy like we have now that's sitting at just over 1% because of so much red tape, so much regulation that it's handicapping businesses. The Western Cape government wants to clamp down on something like 25,000 shebeens because they haven't got licenses. Why? Let them operate. I don't mind. I don't mind if there are 50,000 shebeens without licenses. This is job creation. Plus, it's people going and having a good time on a Friday night. Okay? And it's cheap. Let them. The reason why the pubs and bars become so expensive is because of all the red tape and all the regulation. Let people work. Let people earn money. Stop trying to regulate and implement red tape and slow down their prosperity opportunities. Make it as easy as possible for people to make money. And then you're going to find that the people in the townships will move across into the wealthier suburbs, and maybe a generation later, their kids will have a much easier chance of becoming a pilot.
Yeah, the last part is something that I can agree with. I mean, I see in the comment section a lot of people say that I'm a communist, which is news to me for some reason. Apparently, I want communism.
We need to define communism then, because I also don't think you're... Although they said dude on your wall behind you, it's that Bob Marley.
Yeah, that's not Shay. I don't agree with Shay. It's Bob Marley in the middle, Notorious B.I.G., and then the King of Rock, Freddie Mercury. So yeah, look, I don't know. I think that if we lived in a country where a competent government was in play, I think that where everything would have been improved by is by the education system. I think that if we had an education system that actually worked and uplifted people from previously disadvantaged areas, then affirmative action and broad-based Black economic empowerment wouldn't be needed anymore.
No, but also your problem, Renaldo, is that you weren't forced to do history.
Well, actually, I took history until matric, and that was one of my best subjects. But
no, I was taking a stab at that silly, legislation.
Yeah, but some people might say that, you know, I was still taught the old apartheid history, you know, so that's only why I know some part of it. But yeah, listen, we've been going on for an hour and a half now, so I think we need to conclude this. We can always, it's an hour and a half. We can always, I can always invite you back. I actually enjoyed this discussion.
Me too, because there's so much more to talk about.
Exactly. I know that you want to bitch more about other cartoonists so that you can move from the 39th position.
I'm just looking at the comments, and I see there's this one guy who really doesn't like anything that I say. It's that sees the means of or something. He or she really doesn't like me all that much. I want to meet that person.
Well, welcome to my life. You know, whenever it seems that whenever I do a debate, then the majority of my subscribers are actually not tuned in. It's majority of the other person's subscribers that come onto my channel and then bitches about me.
I must apologize. I had no idea that we've gone half an hour over our time.
Were supposed to do 90 minutes. I just think that, you know, look, I mean, I can go till 11, but I don't think my wife will be happy with me.
So 10 more minutes. Are the people in the comments?
Let's actually move to the comment section to sort of include people. So if you see something that you like, I mean, I would say that from my side, Roman and Willem has been keeping this comment section very busy, you know, more discussing amongst themselves. I know that Willem considers himself like a big conservatist. And I know Roman is an anarchist. I think that it'll be actually good to have Willem to have Roman on his channel. I know that Willem asked if you could be on his channel, but I do think that you, I don't know. I'd rather not say much.
I don't know who Willem is.
That's exactly the same question I had a couple of weeks ago. Willem recently started a YouTube channel. He is a right-leaning individual, very religious, and he's a very good. I enjoy him. He's a good guy for me, but some people fundamentally.
Is he that farmer?
No, he's not a farmer yet. He wants to be a farmer. Willem can speak on behalf of himself here, but if you want to know who Willem is, you can go and check out his YouTube channel.
All right, cool. I will.
He's exploding. He's got. 9,000 subscribers, and he started it like 2-3 months ago. You know, because the right wing people don't have spokespeople on YouTube in South Africa, so they need somebody to represent their beliefs. I don't know. Why aren't you back on YouTube, by the way? What has happened with your YouTube channel?
I also removed myself from Twitter. I'm not very good at public speaking. That's why I draw pictures for a living, and I color them in really badly. I don't know what I'm going to say. If I have a YouTube channel, I don't know what I'm going to talk about. I can only rant so much, and then I'll start going in circles.
Do you actually want people to, let me ask this, because then this might be an idea for your YouTube channel. When you make a cartoon, do you leave it open to a big amount of own interpretation, or do you actually want to get the point across in your cartoons?
That's a good question, actually. So about 2 years ago, I kind of tried to rebrand myself. Not brand myself, but I went on a very personal journey of self-rediscovery, self, what's the word I'm looking for? What are the philosophical terms that make me sound smart?
good luck. I can't give you any. I'm also not that intelligent. So,
but I basically decided I wanted to recreate myself. I was getting very bored of where I was at. I wasn't happy. I was trying to be the middle ground on everything. And I decided that, you know what, I'm going to come out guns blazing with the things that I support and the things that I believe. And as a result, that started people started seeing me more as right wing because I was more aggressive in my work. And I started being ostracized by my colleagues and all that kind of thing. And that's okay. That came with the territory. But I certainly think that I've become a lot more aggressive and, should I say, passionate about the stuff that I'm talking about in my cartoons, particularly in the last 2 years. I'm only focusing on topics that I'm interested in. I don't try and cover all things because I don't know enough about all things to comment on all things. So I comment on the things now that I do find interesting. And it happens to be the case that I've grown in, my support base has grown substantially, despite me not really being in the mainstream anymore.
But maybe then, like, and I'm not, look, I mean, I can only speak from my YouTube perspective here. I think what I would like to watch, because I enjoy your cartoons, what I would like to watch is you drawing the cartoon and talking about your feelings about that cartoon.
You can. You need to become a patron on my Patreon account.
Oh, I see. So you're in it for the money immediately. Oh, that's quite sad.
No, imagine doing a job where I want to get paid. It's a terrible thought.
I know, it's terrible. Okay, well, then I'll definitely do that. But maybe for a YouTube audience, that'll be something cool that you can also then add up and maybe do something like that. You know, just to bold, because I mean, I really did enjoy your News 24 comments. I mean, that was hilarious.
It was pretty funny. I had a good time. I really enjoyed ridiculing the comments. But eventually, as expected, I was called a racist because a lot of people who left comments were black and came from inferior public schooling, and therefore didn't write so well. And then my ridiculing of them apparently made me a racist. But I don't know. I don't make any assumptions based on the comments that I see. I don't know anything about that person. I just see a comment that's written terribly and I ridicule it. But that was back in the days of the News 24 stuff. I enjoyed that.
But have you also noticed how there's been like a radical shift in what is considered acceptable in this country to say, you know, 5 years ago versus now?
Definitely. Let me ask you a question. Do you think people today are more racist than people 25 years ago?
And if so,
post-apartheid, tell me how that happened.
Yeah, look, to answer you, I think that people are, you're always going to have racists. I think that they might, because of the population growth, they are definitely more racist today. But then again, racists are created by racists. So, you know, whether you grow up in a family that considers a black or white person inferior or racist or whatever the problem they might have with that individual, I do think that racism breeds more racism. And also the government, to an extent, you know, the government is not doing themselves any favors by not being stereotyped, you know, as to what they are failing in. So I do think that we have got more racists today than what we had in the past.
Well, I also do think that, I said this earlier in the discussion, I do think that racism is a non-topic. I think people being racist really is not an issue for me, but it's an issue for a lot of people. What I do find problematic is when the state is racist, when it implements legislation that discriminates against people based on the color of their skin. You know, correct me if I'm wrong, but I remember there was this guy who had a dream where he had a dream that people would be judged on the content of their character and not the color of their skin.
He's being facetious.
Who's this guy now that had a dream? Can you remember? I can't pin it.
But I mean, it was not just him. It was also Mandela that said something similar.
Well, exactly. So I think that politicians and a very poor state-run system that's turning very left-wing is creating a bigger sense of discriminatory mindsets. People are so obsessed with skin color and so obsessed with differences in cultures. You can't wear your hair like that. That's cultural appropriation. How dare you, as a white person, wear Zulu attire? That's cultural appropriation. Ugh, please, man, get a life. Yeah. I'll wear whatever I want. You wear whatever you want, and let's get on. Then don't drink coffee, because coffee is also cultural appropriation. You know, it's so silly.
I agree with you, because I wanted to wear my Afrikaans outfit in, you know, to, because whenever in council we it's the cultural month, then people come with their beautiful Xhosa outfit or their Zulu outfit. And I was like, well, maybe I should put on, like, you know, my farmer's outfit with my Rooi Sokkies and stuff. But I'm pretty sure it wouldn't have gone down very well if I had to do that. And that's actually quite sad.
You should, because these days a great way to irritate these radical lefties is to troll them.
Yeah. Listen, another question that I saw and I think we need to wrap it up. And one of the questions I saw here is people asking about the UCT dinner that recently took
place. I think it's fine. I have no issue with it. What I do have an issue with is that you can't organize a dinner for, let's say, Indian people or for white people. I'm absolutely okay with a people of color only dinner. Okay, what I'm not okay with is if UCT applies a double standard to another group of people organizing a dinner. I'm very cool with the idea of having an Italian club where only Italians can go, or a men's only club where only men can go, or a women's only club where only women can go, right? And I don't mind discrimination in that sense at all. And if you want to have a dinner for people of color only, as what they're having at UCT, that's okay. But I would love to see now a whites-only dinner started at UCT, and I would love to see how that's going to fold. I mean, how that's going to roll out in the media. That would be amazing.
Or a straight people-only event, yeah. Something like that. And I have to agree. You see, that is why when people look at my channel, they assume that I'm a social justice warrior, which is problematic, because I really, really dislike social justice warriors. And
yeah.
And even I can admit that if you had to have an event with whites only or straight people only,
yeah,
it would be all over the media. But the UCT thing only became an issue because social media made enough noise about it. I'm not sure if you've noticed this. The media reports on a lot of things that, how can I put it? When it is an issue like, for instance, the Black Vicky Momberg, then the only time the media reports on it is because social media made such a big scene out of it. Whereas Vicky
Penny Sparrow too. She was some unknown estate agent in Durban.
Yeah.
Somewhere there.
But that's my point. Remember that in order for the media to report on something that is not the narrative at the moment, it's when social media has enough outcry. Versus, like, Vicky Momberg made the headlines just because it was news, and there was a social media outcry, but the news hit before the social media outcry was because of the news. Whereas with the Black Vicky Momberg, it's the other way around. The only reason it made some headlines was because social media started the outcry because of it.
But that's exactly correct. It's a mob justice. It's that idea of the people with their pitchforks from the 1500s, you know, and all ganging up on someone to because they don't like that person. I did a cartoon last week where I did the BDS movement, really, really angry and going berserk and burning things and screaming and whatnot. And then two people said, and they were labeled Reason. And the one said to the other, "What are they so angry about?" And he said, the other one says, "Well, someone has an opinion that differs from theirs." And that's pretty much where we are finding ourselves these days, that if you have a different opinion to someone, you're suddenly a racist, you're suddenly a sexist, you're homophobic. I am apparently homophobic. Let me tell you something. I'm engaged, right? And I'm getting married next year. My best man is gay, but apparently I'm homophobic.
Well, that's like using the argument that you've got a black friend.
Yeah, but he doesn't think I'm homophobic. In actual fact, he thinks he's more homophobic than me.
Well, yeah, look, labels. I mean, I think you being a cartoonist, you've been labeled everything under the sun, which you are not. And the same for me, being firstly a politician, be automatically assuming that I'm corrupt. And then obviously this YouTube channel saying that, you know, if I speak against something that a white person did, then I'm considered a race traitor. And if I talk about something that a black individual did, then I'm considered like a racist. So yeah, unfortunately in this country, labels, how can I put it? Labels rule a common sense argument. So
I remember something. As a cartoonist, I love labels.
Yeah, for sure. But I mean, you play on the stupidity of it.
Yes, I play on the stupidity of people. In actual fact, if you think about it, I get paid to do very high level trolling. Because
that's true.
Because I'm provoking people, but I'm also trying to make them think and to talk. You know, if I see a discussion under a cartoon of mine, then already I'm happy. If I see no activity under my cartoon, then I'm a little bit upset about this. Even if everybody disagrees with my cartoon, at least I've triggered a discussion. And that means that I've succeeded at least with that cartoon, and it's a job well done.
Well, okay, here's the last question I've got for you, because it's something that myself and Willem has debated a while. And that is, who do you think are the best trolls at the moment in the political sphere? Do you think the left are better trolls, or do you think the right are better trolls at, you know, bringing out the weakness of the other side?
Definitely the right.
Yeah.
Because right now, the world's greatest troll is Donald Trump, and he's amazing because he has flip-turned the world of politics, the world of media. Donald Trump has basically made the entire world's media into a tabloid. It's incredible. They are publishing fake news left, right, and center because they hate him so much. Hollywood hates him so much. It's wonderful to see how triggered the world, and particularly people on the left, are. Anything he does is evil and terrible, and he's literally Hitler. And it's amazing to see. I find it so hilariously entertaining. It's wonderful. And I certainly think that the left at the moment, particularly the radical left, are so easily trolled and so easily triggered that sometimes you just feel bad for them. You don't want to troll them. You're like, oh no, please, I don't have the heart.
Yeah, I know, like the Young Turks as an example, you can just say anything remotely like trolling and then they'll take it up as seriously. And I mean, this is coming from somebody that's liberal, somebody that, you know, considers himself left-leaning. So I agree with you to an extent that there's a current weakness at the moment.
So I'm just quickly, I'm having to through the comments. I know you want to shoot, and I need to shoot as well. What's the time? It's past my bedtime. But there are some great comments here. Maybe we should do a debate again and pick up on some of these comments.
I think so, because I said the same thing with Adams, is that I'll have him back on. And then what we'll do is we'll focus for about 45 minutes on a debate.
Let's find something we don't agree on.
Okay.
And have a nice argument about something we don't agree on.
Yeah, let's do that. I think that's a good place to start, right? And then obviously, I think that, you know, including the comments, because people, I mean, you don't want to plan ahead and just speak your mind and then sort of that ended. I mean, people ask good questions, both to attack you, or not attack you, but to attack your thoughts, and also to support you. So I think maybe have another one in the future, and then allocate a big amount of time for the comment section. But yeah, any closing things that you would like to say before we end this?
I thoroughly enjoyed chatting to you. It was a lot more fun than I anticipated. Thank you very much for making it great. I do hope that your channel, by the way, is a great success, and I hope it goes even bigger than what it is. The comments are fantastic. I appreciate all the comments. I wish I could meet all these people. They are really good. It's good fun to read their comments. Thanks very much for the opportunity. I hope we do this again soon.
It's only a pleasure. And from my side, yeah, thank you very much. I knew that this debate would be a lot softer, because even though we might disagree on some things, I do think that because we've known each other for a while, we understand where we are with each other and also what our thoughts are. So from my side, thank you very much. And definitely,
hang on. There's a comment asking, is my jacket kudu leather? I don't know, actually. It's a good question. I'll have to look at the label.
Report back on the next video. Kudu leather.
Cheers.
Yeah. All right. Anyway, so guys, please be sure to hit the like button. And also please be sure to subscribe to my channel if you're not subscribed yet. And then
wait, I've just discovered what my leather jacket is.
You keep on interrupting me, Jerm. What the fuck? Anyway.
This jacket, it's made of white privilege.
Oh, you just walked into that one, didn't you? Anyway, all right, guys, if you want to see more of that very dry humor, then go and check out his website. The link is in the description below, jerm.co.za. And as he said earlier, obviously he needs to put bread on the table. So go and support him on Patreon, just like you can support me on Patreon by following the link in the description below. And that's basically all I've got to say. Jerm, thank you very much, and I'll definitely have you back on soon.
Thanks, Renaldo.
And that's basically all I've got to say. Till later, cheers and peace out.